you. I want to thank the organizer for the invitation as well. I'm going to talk about pain, but from a completely different perspective, from the perspective of the observer, someone who sees pain in others. I want to apologize right now for some of the pictures I'm going to show. I didn't expect it to be at lunchtime, and some pictures are not lunch compatible, so I apologize. So when you depict pain, or when we want to depict pain in other people, we can go about different ways. We can show limb pain, body limb pain. We can show facial expressions of pain. We can show both the body limb pain or body pain and facial expressions in a specific context, and other contexts like this where you have different people involved. There's this poor little guy who's not yet in pain because the needle is not in his arm yet, but who's going to be in pain soon. But there are these other people as well. And these are the people I'm interested in. So the caring mom, the doctor, and some dad who had the crazy idea to take the picture at that time. I want to just shift a little bit to talk about empathy, because some of the work we're doing is can be interpreted in the context of empathy. You're gonna have a great talk on empathy next Saturday, I believe, with Simon Byron Cohen. But I want to put my work in perspective as well in the empathy model that we built when I was with Jean Decity's lab back in 2003-04. And the way we conceptualize empathy is, like many people, we think there is an effective component to empathy, mainly a component by which you resonate with other people's emotion. You get an automatic representation of other people's emotion, basically. There's another component which is distinct, by which you can do it deliberately, so consciously you take the perspective of the other person. You think about how the other person is feeling at that moment in that context and so forth. And there's a third component which I believe regulates all the other mechanisms, by which it prevents you from being immersed in the other person's experience or being over affected by the other person's experience. So you can navigate between your own perspective and the perspective of the other. A lot of models of empathy have not addressed the main issue of the pro-social intention or attitude towards the others. These cognitive mechanisms could be used to do some harm to someone, in a sense. But we conceptualize empathy mainly in a context where someone wants to help somebody else. Another way to put it, to conceptualize it, is so there's an effective component, which I believe is fairly automatic, non-conscious. The mentalizing, other people have called this mentalizing aspect, where you decouple and you think about the other person, you put yourself in the shoes of the other person, and the regulation, which brings the equilibrium in the system. And eventually you want all these cognitive processes to be at the service of doing good to other person. So this model could be applied to different emotions, different reactions, not necessarily just pain, but I'm going to use it or keep this in mind when I talk about pain. So back to pain now. What the question we asked ourselves back in 2003 was, to what extent do we share other people's pain when we see something like that? We get the visual stimulus that goes to the visual cortex, but we don't get any other information from the periphery. So what mechanisms or what systems are going to be used to process this information? That's the main question. And are these systems the same or similar to those that are known to be involved in processing actual pain or pain from nociception? We know more and more about the functional organization of pain from, well, the conceptualization of the neural matrix. I think, well, this term encompasses different dimensions of pain, the sensory discriminative component, which is the where and how, to what level does it hurt, the affective motivational component, by which we're going to rate the pain in terms of unpleasantness, for instance, and cognitive evaluative, where we can gauge a bit in different contexts whether it hurts or whether it doesn't hurt, and how we get influenced by other kind of information and even social context as well. These regions are regions involved in different dimensions of pain, but they're not pain regions. People have used the term pain matrix to say that there are certain regions of the brain that are activated by pain systematically. Well, it might be the case that pain activates a certain number of regions systematically, but it doesn't mean that they're specific to pain. Other cognitive processes also can activate these regions. So I just wanted to make that clear, that brain imaging, we make association between regions and cognitive processes, but doesn't mean a region is specific to that process. So the first experience we ran we asked ourselves, well, when you see a picture like this, where there is clearly pain, and you compare it to a visually comparable stimuli without the pain, stimulus without the pain, what do you get in terms of brain activation? So we got systematically anterior cingulate cortex, anterior insular cortex, which are two of the regions which are mostly associated with the affective dimension of pain. When you give nociceptive stimuli in people in a scanner, you get these activations systematically. So other people at the same time got similar types of result, Morrison and Singer. And Singer, the interesting part was that she did not show visual stimuli of pain, but she just showed a cross indicated, a cross of different colors indicated in some cases that the partner was receiving pain, other cases the partner was not receiving pain. So just the concept of my partner is receiving pain right now activated the same kind of system. This was also found for facial expressions of pain at the same time by Bud Vinnick and Pierre Rainville's lab as well. And it showed the same kind of affective dimension of pain seems to be represented in facial expression, which is not surprising for facial expression. But for bodily pain like this, we would expect some activation in the somatosensory area, either S1, S2 primary or secondary somatosensory area, which we did not find at the time, neither us nor other teams. And we wondered why, because seeing a hand like this versus a foot receiving a shovel, for instance, is not the same thing, and we must encode part of the sensory aspect too, but we weren't able with these techniques. Later on, other people with other techniques like TMS, MEG, or EG, which were sometimes more specific, were able to show that the sensory discrimination dimension of pain seems to be modulated by looking at pain. And even with fMRI, later studies showed that, well, you see S1 activation when you observe pain in other people. But what one of the factors that made, well, or the difference between this study and the earlier studies is mainly a difference in instructions. Because as we were told before, just by saying something to someone in a scanner, you can modulate a bit the type of activity you'll get. So if you ask, for instance, someone, look at this pain and imagine where the pain is localized, as opposed to an instruction, imagine how unpleasant the pain is, well, you'll get in a case of localization more S1 activation. So you lead the subject toward more the sensory discriminative dimension as opposed to the more effective motivational dimension in the other case. So in my lab, what we wanted to do is to tap a little bit more on this somatosensory processing by designing a new kind of a study using EEG, but instead of using EEG like other people have used, for example, event-related potential, how it's most traditionally used. We've designed a study where we induce a state, a sensory state in individual. So we have people receive a vibration at a fixed frequency. and fixed frequency, for instance, 25 hertz. And we induce a state of sensation in the person, and we're able to extract the data from that 25 hertz band, getting the signal of just this sensation, if you want. And what we want to do is to see whether, when you introduce visual stimuli, this trace of the sensory activity will change. So by introducing limbs in pain, we want to check whether that signature will be changed. And what we found was that, well, first of all, you see from the backside of the brain, a central parietal regions here, different electrodes are represented here. What you see is that over time, the energy level in scalp current density, that drops drastically when you see the first pictures. That's kind of an expected gating effect, in the sense that you feel a sensation, and when you see something, the level of energy related to that sensation will drop. And that's what we see here for basically all sites. But in this site here, in the contralateral, on the left side, people receive stimulation on the right side, you see more drop for one condition, which was the hand pain condition. So there seemed to be hand pain compared to hand neutral or foot pain, foot neutral, a very specific modulation of this energy or this excitability, I could say. So seeing a hand in pain as opposed to seeing a foot in pain will not modulate the somatosensory system the same way. Then there were an explosion of studies looking at pain in other people, and people have tried different things, and we kind of regrouped them in three different components or subgroups. People have modulated either the stimuli, so what you look at, whether you look at facial expression, body pain, hand, foot, what have you, or the task even. Other studies have looked at the individual himself or herself, the age, the gender, the personality traits, the physical state. I'll show a few examples later on. And most interestingly, people have started to look at the what I call the self-other interaction. So who's the person you're looking at in relation to yourself, the observer? And that's more interesting. So I'm going to give you a few examples of all of these from my lab and others. One simple question we had for years and never managed to run the experiment until recently with Pierre Rainville, Etienne Dachon-Presseau, his student, is we wondered, well, if you look at body pain as opposed to facial expression of pain, you must get differential activation at some level. The pain component might be there, but there might be something else. And indeed, we found that for images of bodily pain, you get more somatosensory region, more activity in somatosensory regions. As compared to the facial expression, you get more of what we call the mentalizing network. Other people have called the mentalizing network the medial prefrontal cortex and precuneus. This is not, well, that surprising either, because when you see pain from a facial expression, you don't get the context. You don't get what's happening to that person, except that this person is in pain. So you try probably to infer what's going on with that person. Why is that person expressing that pain at that moment? Another way to look at the task with a visual or the visual component of the stimuli, we ask ourselves, well, in the first studies we ran, we always put the limb of the person in first-person perspective. And we wanted by that to increase the simulation or increase the process of thinking it was the people's hand. So we kind of not cheated, but we put it in our favor. But what we want to do, well, is that visual perspective something that really changes the way we represent the pain of others? So we ran a study where we had stimuli shot from two different angles, one that it looks like your own hand and one that looks like somebody else's hand. I want to see, okay, well, you get the same changes in the somatosensory processing as in those two conditions. And we use the same EEG paradigm, steady state, that I discussed earlier. And first of all, we show that people, for the same scenarios, they attribute more pain level here for the first person perspective. So when you see the hand in the first person, you attribute more pain than the third. And again, the same region from a different angle, get the gating effect, all conditions combined. But if you look at the first person versus the third person perspective, you get a strong effect for the first person perspective when you compare pain versus no pain in the first person. When you compare the third person perspective, you get not a significant effect until much, much later on. So you get the differential response from seeing the stimuli from the first to the third person, a differential response probably in visual areas and other associative areas as well. But here we're talking about just the somatosensory processing. Something else we wonder, and that's something that Jorge has been talking about, is that when you show some people in a scanner pictures, you never control fully what they're looking at, what they're actually seeing. And what we wanted to do is to modulate, well, to control for that by giving instruction to, in some cases, you look at the facial expression and you ask them, okay, rate the level of pain you see that this person is depicting. And in another condition, you get the same expression, but you ask the person to rate the level of movement or the discrimination of where you see more movement in the face. Is it more towards the mouth or the eyes? Because some people have a different, well, they move more the eyes than the face. So we ask them a movement discrimination task or a pain discrimination task. One of the first thing we saw, first of all, is that regardless of the task, the more pain in the picture, the more, the higher the pain level of the picture, the higher or the more activity in regions of the so-called pain matrix, like anterior insula, anterior cingulate cortex, and so forth. When we compare directly the pain assessment task, which is in orange here, and the movement discrimination task, the reverse contrast, which shows in blue here, you see that the pain assessment task activates medial prefrontal, like anterior insula, as opposed to the movement discrimination task will activate more sensory motor regions like the superior frontal gyrus, inferior parietal lobe, which makes sense, but which also, again, reminds us that the same stimuli can trigger very different mechanisms, very different systems, depending on what the person is doing while supposedly looking at these pictures. So we get some pain-related possibly activation when you think about pain, but not when you're not thinking about pain. Another way we manipulated this instruction, but a bit differently, back when I was in the city's lab, we used the bodily pain, but instead of switching the visual perspective, we switched the cognitive perspective. So in one case, we asked people, okay, imagine how much pain you would get yourself if you had your hand stuck there. And in some other condition, we ask, imagine if that hand was this technician here, this technician's hand. So this manipulation also was associated with differential rating of the pain. You get more pain if you just think it's your hand as opposed to somebody else's hand, even if it's the same scenarios. But you also get, when you do a contrast of self versus other activation, you also get more activity in so-called pain matrix areas, anterior cingulate cortex, anterior insula, and also somatosensory cortex, secondary somatosensory cortex, which we didn't get when you just look at the pictures without thinking about yourself being in that situation. So what we think is that when you think about yourself in a situation, you kind of get even closer to the actual feeling, sensation you would get if you were yourself receiving that pain, really. In all the studies we've done, we often use bodily pain, but with situation like a knife, a door, some threat to the person. So we thought, okay, well, even if the knife goes away from the finger or far from the finger, you still see a knife there that could potentially hit the finger. and we wondered, okay, what happens? Do you anticipate the pain as soon as you see a knife and a potential threat, as opposed to seeing just a more benign condition where you just flip a page of a book or take a tissue, for instance, or even if you touch your finger with a flower, which would not be threatening. So we ran the same study again, same design, EEG, steady state, same region looking at here. So you see the big drop of energy when you see the different conditions, but you see the neutral condition here has much less gating effect, if you want, a much less drop in energy than the other two conditions. So as soon as when you see the first few pictures, but as soon as you see the third pictures where the actually the limb is getting touched or cut or not cut, that's where you see the split between the pain and no pain. So you get an initial response very early, which is similar whether it's pain or no pain, if there is some anticipation of pain in there. But that study we ran, actually, this was just a condition we added, the neutral. And the idea behind the first or that study was not anticipation at all. But we wanted to test whether individual characteristic can change the pattern of results or can influence the way the brain responds to the pain of others. And what we did is we tested 160 people with a psychopathy checklist, and we selected the people at the very end of that checklist. So those people who rated the most and the least on that checklist, and we ran the same, well, the study you saw previously. And when we look at the individual groups, you see that one group does not seem to differentiate between the condition as much, as opposed to the other group, which shows very large differences or very significant differences between the condition. And one, well, interesting thing is that this group is the group that shows very high psychopathic traits, which kind of could be counterintuitive, but that's I just want to remind you that we're not testing empathy here. We're just testing the precursor, the response to an aversive stimulation. And in this case, it seems that people with high psychopathic trait might be more responsive than others, which might later on explain how these people will develop later and in a clinical sense could eventually lead to other disorders. I've been asked many times, what if you put people who torture other people in the scanner while you show them pain? What will happen, or what will you see in terms of brain region? Well, I don't have access to torturers, and they don't enlist to enroll in our study. But a group recently used a clinical population, sadistic people, and they showed that these people, when you show them pain, they do activate, well, some temporal parietal region here, but they do activate the amygdala, which I haven't talked about a lot, well, at all so far. Amygdala we don't see typically in images of pain, when you see pain, except, and I'll talk about it later, for some facial expressions of pain. And here you get amygdala for these people yet. So is this a threat? All these people find it threatening? Probably not, but there are some maybe reward mechanism involved or pleasure system involved at seeing these pictures of pain by these people. Another very interesting population that has been tested with the paradigms of observing pain in others are people with congenital insensitivity to pain. These people are born with a problem in small caliber nerve fibers and have basically no nociception, and they never feel pain. And so we wanted, well, these people, Nicola Danzinger, wanted to test whether these people could still interpret the type of stimuli we're using as being painful. And they're adult people now, and they're able to attribute pain to others, but their ratings were systematically lower and always more variable. So they are able to rate the pain of other people, even though they never had pain, but they tend to attribute less pain. And one interesting finding was that the level of the rating that people, these patients, gave was correlated with the level of empathy, self-reported empathy, that these people gave. So it seems that although they don't have this, possibly this simulation mechanism going on because they never felt pain, so they can't resonate with the pain of somebody else, but they are able to, through another route, assess the pain of other people. And this study also suggests that, well, the experience, the hands-on experience of pain is not necessarily required to be able to assess the pain of other people. They ran a neuroimaging study afterwards, and the same cohort, and basically, essentially what this is showing is that controls and patients show the same pattern of results, which is kind of surprising as well. Seems that these patients activate the same region when they see pain, even though they never felt pain. So probably suggests that they're going through another route in there, or these regions are not pain related. Another way to look at how the brain can be influenced by pain is, people that are exposed to pain often are healthcare professionals, nurses, doctors, and some people think that the fact that you're being exposed, overexposed to pain, can change the way you process pain, and eventually, some might not agree with that, but eventually the way you treat pain as well. I'm not getting there today, but some earlier study by Chang and DeSetti showed that they tested acupuncturists compared to controls, and the acupuncturists, when you show them pictures of acupuncture needles penetrating the skin, they give much less intensity of pain than normal controls. So normal controls will attribute more pain to that scenario. And normal controls will also activate more at the anterior insula, anterior cingulate cortex. So they show more response to the pain than the expert who know that this is not that painful, who have seen these stimuli often. And they also show more activation in the medial prefrontal cortex. And the authors interpret that as being a modulation or a dampening, perhaps, of the initial simulation response. Now, the self-other interaction, there are several ways we can look at that. In the lab, very simply, we want to see, okay, if we're talking about similar systems involved in self-pain and the observation of pain in others, what happens if you are in pain and you're seeing the pain of other people? Will the fact that you are in pain influence your judgment of the pain of others? So we ran a study where we use a thermode inflicting pain to subject. Yes, this is ethically done, but we inflict pain in terms of 5-6 out of a 0 to 10 scale. And people then, when they receive either pain or heat, they have to score the facial expression of pain. What we expected is that you'd get more rating, and the fact that you're in pain would make you attribute more pain to the other people. And this is what we found here. So in orange, you see the rating of the facial expression of pain for a low, medium, and high facial expression, and it's higher systematically as opposed to when you're receiving a warm stimulation. So the fact that you're in pain will give you more rating. But this was the case only for half of the scenarios, being the male facial expressions. Regardless of whether you're a male or female subject, if you see a male facial expression, you'll get this heightened response. When people see female subject expressing pain, you don't get that additional effect, and even worse, when you see a female expressing a lot of pain and you are yourself in pain, whether you're a male or female, you tend to underestimate the pain of the female. One possible explanation for this in terms of evolutionary, if you want, evolutionary mechanism is what we think, and there are other data showing that the facial expression of males is more threatening and more aversive than the facial expression of pain from females. So that needs to be tested more, but we have other data showing that, and actually in Pierre Rainville's lab in 2006, I believe, they ran a study where they showed people facial expression of pain, and they showed that the male subjects showed a different pattern of activity than not the male subject, but again, the cerebral activity was different depending on whether it was a female or male scene. If you see a female, you see activity in the pain matrix and so forth, as well as in the male. But in the male, you also saw, when you see a male, they also saw increased activity in the amygdala, only for when looking at the male, so which goes with the threat hypothesis or threat value of a male facial expression of pain. Now, we also wanted to ask in Pierre Rainville's lab the reverse paradigm. Well, if you are seeing someone in pain and you receive pain, will that change the way you perceive the pain? Will that change your response to the nociceptive stimulus? So we had people look at facial expression of pain again, and we use a electric shock to provoke a nociceptive reflex at the ankle. And we looked at the amplitude of that reflex depending on what they saw. And the amplitude of the reflex increases depending on whether you see mild, moderate, or strong facial expression. So seeing a strong facial expression of someone experiencing a lot of pain will amplify the nociceptive reflex, if you want. It will also amplify your subjective assessment of the pain from that shock. So you'll give more pain if you're seeing facial expression of high pain. And interestingly, we also tested the facial expression of subject by measuring muscles in the face, notably the corrugator, which is involved in the facial expression of pain. And when people just were looking at the facial expression, the level of pain of the expression did not modulate much the facial expression of the subject. But after receiving the shock, people expressed more pain, and the level of pain or the change in the muscle activity was dependent on the level of pain shown prior in the images. So there seems to be a priming effect of your own facial expression when you see facial expression of pain prior to a nociceptive stimulus. So now back to the relationship between self and other. A lot of people have try this, and the concept of similarity between the target and the observer have been explored different ways: mother-child interaction, friends, teammates, fans of the Canadian versus fans of the Maple Leafs, and so forth. So the hypothesis is that the closer you feel to the other person, the more assimilation should take place, and the more activity in the so-called pain matrix should be observed as well. One group that did that is the group of Han in China. And what they did is that they asked Caucasian people and Chinese people to look at Caucasian faces and Chinese faces receiving painful stimulation or non-painful stimulation. And what they saw is that the activity in the anterior cingulate cortex for the Caucasian people was increased or significantly higher when they saw Caucasian as opposed to Chinese faces, and the opposite was true for Chinese people. They saw the anterior cingulate cortex was more activated when they saw Chinese than when they saw Caucasian people. And what's also interesting in that study is that the subjective rating of the pain from those two groups did not differ at all. So people, when they have to consciously, objectively, or subjectively rate the pain of others, they don't make this differentiation that the brain seems to make when you see someone from your own group. Another group, Tanya Singer, did a neat study as well, but trying to, this time, to manipulate the interaction you had with someone. So before, having people in the scanner and looking at the response of the brain when the other receives pain. They had people play a neuroeconomic game together. And some of the people with which they played, they were they played fairly and they were cooperative, and other people were very unfair and uncooperative. So then they compared the brain response to the cooperative versus non-cooperative players, and what they show is that people get more response in the anterior insula here when you get fair people, when you observe fair people receiving pain as opposed to unfair people. So you are more, you resonate more with the pain of somebody with which you played fairly as opposed to unfairly. This differential effect was stronger for males. So male subject this time, showed more activity for fair players than unfair players. What was unexpected finding of this study is that actually males, not only did they show more activity for fair than unfair players, but they showed more activity in regions of the reward system for unfair players. So unfair players receiving pain, they got some activity in the reward system, which the authors attribute to a possible desire for revenge or so forth. So it wasn't the case for females, but males seem to show that trend. So back to the model of empathy, I think if we want to move forward from this, what I've shown you today about seeing the pain of others as responding to the pain of others, to a model of empathy, we need to, first of all, measure the pro-social intention of or behavior towards the other person. Seeing someone in pain is something, but doing something about that pain is something else. It's another level that we want to address in our lab by asking people, for instance, to spend some time or more time with a person or a patient or less time with a patient, trying to figure out a way to measure this help behavior. And eventually, I think we need to take into account the other person and the response of the other person. If we want to truly talk about empathy, empathy is an interactive situation or interactive. It's an interaction, basically. So you have someone who empathizes for the other one, but the other one is responsive as well. And the response of that person towards the first person's empathy will also play a role in the whole empathic circle or cycle. So briefly in conclusion, the response to observing pain, the experience of pain in others, and seems to involve the same system as those associated with nociception, although they're not necessarily specific for nociception. The response can include the simulated more resonance aspect, which I've talked about more, or also more the mentalizing component of empathy, if we want. And one thought is that this later component likely evolved later on with socialization. I think people need to reach beyond that aversive initial response to the pain of others to get to a more pro-social stance. So in terms of timing, we probably get a more initial simulated response, and later on we deliberately take the perspective of the other person. Some have argued that, well, the resonance mechanism might be a facilitator of the empathic response, but others have argued that it might not even be necessary, and the patients with congenital insensibility to pain seems to show that, well, it's not necessary. That's it. So I want to thank my collaborators, financial support, and my team. Thank you.